Sweet. We'll be right back. Hey, everybody. Welcome on back to our little Cowtown Puppet Show here. It's the Rocksmith 2014 weekly live stream with real live developers here from Studio SF. Hi, everybody. My name's Dan Amrick. I'm the community developer on behalf of Studio SF. And yeah, you know, if you were looking for a challenge that was a bass-oriented challenge, this is your week, obviously. Four songs from Primus. There they are. And one of them being really tiny that we did at the top of the show, the 27-second masterpiece of the South Park theme. And that's available for 99 cents if you want to get that alone because it is tiny. So, you know, that's only fair. But it also comes in the 4-pack, which is priced as a 3-pack. So you're basically getting that whole song free and another one at a slight discount. Depends on how you put it. But they're your fingers, and you're going to have to answer for them because, holy cow, this material is difficult this week. As you probably already know if you've given it a try. try. You might be able to give it a try if you win one of the DLC codes we're giving away later today as part of the stream. And, yeah, we actually got some people that said, oh, Rocksmith, you guys don't like bassists at all. And I think this is proof. Like, we really wanted you to suffer. I think they were thinking, like, you're not giving us enough material that's challenging and interesting, to which there can now be no doubt this week. But, yeah, really, how much are you suffering for this? Because you're Jason Kokel, hi.
Hi.
You did Jerry Was a Race Car Driver. You did the transcription for that. And Jared's going to be sitting in on guitar. And we'll get to the special bit in a minute. But how impossible was this? Because you're a pretty technical player.
I don't know. I mean, I got this album when it came out. And I learned how to play that main riff of the bass part, like, immediately. So it was that part wasn't that difficult. I mean, the song really only has two parts on the bass, but they are difficult. I mean, to play. It's not easy if you are learning bass
right
at the same time as learning the song.
Yeah, don't start with this, I guess, is what we're saying. This is
or
is,
do.
This is something that we've seen, too, where people say, hey, I'll never be able to play that correctly. I'm not even going to bother to buy it, which is never something we want to hear you say.
Yeah.
But remember, the game is going to step you up in dynamic difficulty. So even if it's ultimately a super challenging song, you will be able to play it at whatever level you can play it by just giving it a try a few times, and dynamic difficulty will adjust. So don't be too scared off by any song in the Rocksmith library. That's why Rocksmith is here, to help easily level that up with dynamic difficulty, so that I have dynamic difficulty saying that phrase.
And it's not just so there's the dynamic difficulty where Rocksmith is doing it all for you, but there's also you have complete manual control over the difficulty at any time. You can go in and raise all the difficulty up, lower it back down. Something I've done a few times is go in, lower everything down, play it up to a level where it starts getting really hard, go back in, go all the way back down to zero, play it until it levels up, and each time I find myself inching up a little bit higher.
Sure. And you're doing something interesting doing the this is Jared McAdams, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey guys.
You have decided that the completely insane solo for this song, you've decided to level that down significantly so that I mean, but the rest of the song you're going to play at 100% because it's achievable to you right now, but the solo is tricky.
I just really didn't have a whole lot of time to put in any extra practice time,
that's the reality of working here.
I worked up the rest of the chart pretty okay. But the solo is just not something I was going to be able to spend enough time on to get it under my fingers. So I'm going to play it at easy level.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's do it then.
Let's
do Jerry Was a Race Car Driver. And I think actually as Brian Pody on the Wheels of Steel switches over, you can see that little chunk of black and orange. That's the part that's not leveled up all the way. The way to read the horizon is that anything in purple is at 100% difficulty. Anything in orange, there is still some place to grow as in complexity. So, here you go. It's fun.
Jerry was Nailed it.
Well, this is really good. It's just giving you anchor notes so that as you build up complexity, it's sort of like filling in the stones on a footpath almost. Like, these will help you orient yourself as you get better. Plenty of comments. Jason looks a little bit like Les Claypool, said somebody.
Nice.
Jared Lalonde is in there. Kind of great. Yeah, and somebody pointed out that the craziest thing about it is not only is that bass... I was intentionally staying quiet so as not to ruin anybody's concentration today, but when Les Claypool plays it live, he sings it.
Right, while doing
that core riff, which
and
I,
it looks so effortless.
Yeah, I mean...
His arms look all floppy like a 30s cartoon.
Yeah. So, anything to add to that? Any advice or approach?
I think with something like this, so I used this bass because the action was really low, and I tried to get it as close to playing a six-string fretless without actually doing, which, I mean, that's what it's played on.
Sure.
And so this arrangement was adapted from that. But still, the issue is that these strings are so close together, it makes it even harder to play. So a bit about the arrangement. These notes that are tapped, it's actually supposed to be here and on the missing string that's on a six-string bass. So it's this note's an octave higher, so he'd be tapping these, which I can't get because they don't exist on the instrument. And there's also the low B string that during the breakdown at the end, just before they, he's kind of having this. There's a low B that's ringing out that we just don't have, and hitting a low E over it doesn't sound as good. So just kind of, so it makes it harder to play, I think, on a four string rather than the actual instrument it was written for. And he's pretty loose. I mean, it's a specific part, but he embellishes every once in a while, we're putting all that in there. And that's what kind of makes it a little harder to play. Good luck.
It's
really are only two parts, but they're very difficult parts.
Right.
To learn and play.
But again, take them a little bit at a time. Take it as you can get it. You will get better at this. We swear. It's just a matter of repetition and practice, and it's nature of the beast.
And on the point about the different instruments, I know when I've seen Primus shows, a lot of times he'll just play a four string bass throughout the show. He's not switching instruments throughout, so he just makes it work on the instrument the same way that we're doing.
Usually this song he plays specifically on a six string, just because of there are different, there are notes that he doesn't have.
Like
I think any footage I've seen of this song specifically, he'll switch to it. But yeah, I mean, he's a competent player and can do his weird stuff on any of his weird instruments. So.
I mean, honestly, a lot of people were like, well, why would you even do this if you're not including a six-string, bass tablature? Well, because, the 0.02% of people that play Rocksmith that also have six-string fretless basses, I think maybe if Les Claypool has a copy of Rocksmith, that would be the one.
Yeah, one person.
But if you transcribe it for and rearrange it for a four-string, then it's suddenly very accessible. Yes, it's difficult, but it just makes more sense, guys.
Yeah. If he was playing it on a four string, he'd probably do it the same way. Because that note that's missing, it's like, well, okay, I could play it here. And also the other thing is that jump is significant. But if you have the sixth string, you can play these.
You can play it somewhere in the middle of the neck.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what he does. He doesn't jump way up there. He plays it down here, but we don't have.
Well, several people are saying it was a heroic job that you guys even transcribed it, and they appreciate that even happened. So well done.
Right on. Thanks.
Well done.
Thanks, everyone.
Let's do a giveaway while we swap these guys out. How about some bass stuff for you bassists? There it is. It's the Ernie Ball Slinky Prize pack, we've got two sets of Ernie Ball Slinky Strings, one regular and one cobalt. The cobalts are higher output and made with a different alloy, so you may find that you like the tone of those better. But hey, if we give you a set of each for free, then you're the one that can figure out which one you like better. And of course, you get pretty much everything else that you see here as well. The Wonder Wipes, which will keep your guitar nice and shiny and bright. And I'm a big fan of that, especially conditioning the fretboard. You know, your rosewood fretboards particularly, even your ebony fretboards, they need a certain amount of a natural oil to feel and look good. And the Wonder Wipes will do that for you. A brand new strap from Ernie Ball. Of course, that's always a good thing. Some picks from both us and from Ernie Ball. Ernie Ball will give you 12. We're stingy. We only give you 3 with a Rocksmith logo on them. And of course, a peg winder as well to make your string changing easier on the guitar that you may or may not own. A friend did say he has a Hofner bass, and the guitar peg winder does, in fact, work on the Hofner bass tuning peg. So you may have a bass that has really tiny little tuning pegs, in which case, feel free to use that. Otherwise, maybe you can bribe your friendly guitarist with it as a gift. So Anthony Martinez there is calibrating his guitar. David Stevens is calibrating his bass as well. If you look at Facebook tomorrow, you'll probably see another reminder of exactly how to do that. But in the tuning menu, there's also at the lower right corner of the tuning screen, it says calibrate. And if you do that, that's going to tell Rocksmith how loud your pickups are, what kind of output they have, and so that it can more accurately judge the dynamics of what you're playing. And so that it doesn't say, nope, you didn't get that, when in fact you got that. So if you're having problems with the game detecting what you're playing, that might be a factor. Do make sure, especially if you wind up changing between guitar and bass, or between multiple guitars, different tunings especially, it is worth taking the extra 15, 20 seconds or whatever it takes to go into the calibration screen and make sure that that's all working for you. Hi, gentlemen. How you doing?
Hello.
Feeling good? Feeling up to this?
Fabulous.
Yeah? Because... we all sort of like went in the meeting when we realized it was Primus week, yeah. And you guys are having to bear the brunt of this. As the chat room was quick to point out, I'll bet you Dan's not playing bass this week. yeah, that'd be correct. And it's funny because I actually did play guitar on Jerry Was a Race Car Driver in my college band in a backyard gig. And that was because our bassist had a 4-string bass, and he loved Primus. He's like, we're doing this song. And I'm like, okay, I don't know how to play any. And I just played random notes, and everybody was like, dude, you nailed that solo. I'm like, now I figured out how to play Primus. Don't know what you – sometimes ignorance is bliss, and that was absolutely one of those places. But you both have to play along to a specific note track, and you have no excuse because one of you made the note track, and offense.
No, Matt.
Is this a Matt Montgomery thing?
Yeah.
So you're
Matt.
Thanks, Matt. So you guys are both stepping up to fill in for the mighty Matt Montgomery.
Yes, sir.
What have you learned about Winona's Big Brown Beaver or Matt Montgomery out of this by trying to deconstruct this? What do you recommend? What should people look out for in this song?
Taco Bell.
Yeah, 7-layer, sure. Anything else, or is it just one of those things where you have to... Does everything we said about the previous song apply?
As far as the bass goes, it all rides throughout the entire song. So as you level up, just get used to playing that, you know, as the backbone of the song, and then you work the melody.
Everything else is embellishments and melody on top of that core root note.
I actually played the guitar chart for the first time a couple of hours ago, and I didn't realize how involved it is. Man. So shortly after, I told Brian Pody that it needs to be leveled down the whole
That's
way through.
That's fair.
There's
no
lead
shame
work
in
is
that.
Very tricky.
Except
I wish I had
you.
More time to work on it. There's some really tasty guitar licks in there.
I know the feeling. Some people in the chat, Brian Pody, said, can we see the bass chart a little larger? So would you mind going to the big game little cam for this next song so that people can sort of look and see what's going on in the bass chart a bit more, since that is kind of the spotlight this week. Are you otherwise ready to give this a shot and get it over with? I know there's a certain amount of like, okay, can do this. I believe you can do this. The chat room believes you can do this, except for that one guy. He does not like you at all.
That guy.
We still love him.
Yeah, all right. Well done. So this is Winona's Big Brown Beaver, one of four songs in the Primus pack this week. $7.99 USD. Should be available now in all territories and all of that fun stuff. And yeah, here's the big look at the transcription. But of course, you're buying it this week, right? So you'll be able to see this all from you know, yourself. Les Claypool has confirmed this is about neither Winona Ryder nor Winona Judd. He just picked the name because he thought it sounded interesting. Congratulations to BuildBob49 for winning the first base pack. I'll send you out that pack ASAP once we get all your details. We have more to give away later on in the show. Building block. So the great Spriter Brad, yeah, congratulations. So we have a masseuse standing by for your right hand.
Good.
Somebody mentioned the great Spriter Brad said this seems like it's the most accessible of the pack. If we discount the South Park theme, which again, like you might be able to get all the way through just because it's short. Would you agree? Is this sort of the best one for people to start with in terms of bass?
Yeah, I mean, there's no tapping, there's no slapping. So, I mean, unless you're really comfortable with those techniques,
right.
It keeps it to the more straightforward, just pluck and fret.
Okay. Any
that's the same with the guitar part, yeah. Aside from the solos.
Yeah, aside from the solos, that's fine.
Yeah.
And again, that was done at about 50%, 50%-ish mm-hmm. Difficulty. Again, you can always go into Riff Repeater and say, you know what, let me override dynamic difficulty and bang it out at this difficulty and see how it goes. You can also go into Guitarcade, do Score Attack, and there are presets for easy, medium, hard. So if you want to sort of stab at it that way and say, I don't even want to have to make a decision. I want it on easy and see what it's like, and then try medium. You can do that for any of the material in the game as well.
Yeah, Matt also did a really good job of interpreting the slide guitar work.
Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds great.
Cool. Yeah. Well, I'll let you guys take a break. Take a break. We've got a giveaway. If you want to actually give this stuff a ride, you might find that you're better at it than you think. And wouldn't it be nice to get it for free? So Jason Paradise in our chat room has 5 Steam codes for this DLC pack, all 4 songs. He will tell you what you need to do to win. Just follow his advice to the letter. And, of course, this is a very bass-heavy pack this week. If you don't have a bass but you're intrigued, you know, there is this mode in Rocksmith 2014 called emulated bass mode that we don't think a lot of people know about or use. So if you don't have a 4-string, you just have a 6-string, you can still kind of play a little bit on the other side of the fence. And Jared is here with a video to tell you all about that. And when we come back, Backtrack Spotlight with Sublime. Thanks for tuning in. We'll be right back.
Hey everybody, my name's Jared McAdams, and I'm going to be talking to you a little bit today about emulated bass. So you all know about the regular pads. You've got lead, you've got rhythm, and you've got bass. And you should totally jump around between all the pads as much as you want. There's no penalty for moving between them, and if you don't check them out, you're missing out on a lot of the content in the game. But there's actually a 4th option. Emulated bass. Now this is where you use your guitar to play bass arrangements. So here I am in lead mode and you can hear the menu tone for lead path sounds like this. And now let's switch to bass and see what that sounds like. Okay, it still sounds like a guitar, right? It doesn't sound like a bass all of a sudden. It's still the same pitch. To make it sound like a bass, it needs to be shifted down an octave. So I'm going to go here to the options menu, and under play settings, I'm going to select emulate bass. Now listen. Okay, so that's low, right? That's a low note. That's a bass note. It sounds like a bass. So now we can use that to play songs in the game, and it will actually sound like you're playing a bass. When you're in emulated bass mode, the tuner works essentially the same way as when you're in guitar mode, except you only have to tune 4 strings. And notice here in the tuner, you can actually switch emulated bass on and off here in the tuner instead of going into the options menu. That's actually probably generally a better way to do it. Okay, so why would you want to do this? For one, there's just great stuff in the game that's awesome, awesome music where the bass is doing totally its own thing that has nothing to do with what's going on in the guitar, where the bass is really the main instrument. Here's an example of that. This is What's Going On by Marvin Gaye, one of the great bass lines, one of the great bass players in Rocksmith. You should check this out if you haven't had a chance to. Here's a little bit of that.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother.
Another reason you might want to check out the emulated bass is that sometimes it's a little easier than a guitar part. Sometimes it's actually just the same as the guitar part, but just the bass notes, just the root notes of the chords. When you have that kind of situation, the bass becomes like a single note version of the song, and it can be a good intermediate step. Let's check out Blitzkrieg Bop. That's basically what's going on here. The bass is playing pretty much what the guitar is playing, just isn't playing the chords. So if you're still working up to chords, this might be a good place to start. Okay, so most bass parts are not going to be completely different from the guitar part, and most aren't going to be completely identical to the guitar part. Most are going to kind of dance around it. This is Say It Ain't So by Weezer. Here you can see I'm playing the root notes of the chords, but I'm also kind of doing some other things. That's a good one to check out. Finally, like I said before, if you're not playing all the paths, you're missing out on a lot of the content of the game. I personally think that some of the funnest charts in the whole game, funnest or most fun, funnest, the most enjoyable charts in the game are bass charts sometimes, so you should check those out. Also, bass playing is kind of a different kind of approach to music from playing guitar, and it helps you wrap your brain around some ideas that maybe you're not going to get to the same degree in guitar charts. Things like groove and root movement and harmonic rhythm, the rate at which new harmonic information comes up. That's all much more exposed in the bass guitar charts, so you might want to check it out for that reason. And finally, for you beginners out there, like I said, this can be a great way to get your feet wet without worrying too much about chords and solos and things that might be a little bit intimidating. So that's a quick look at emulated bass. Check it out. It's a lot of fun.
Hi, everybody, and welcome back to the second half of the Rocksmith 2014 weekly developer live stream. That's Brian Pody. Brian Posey. Nice pose.
Yeah.
Woo! I'm Dan Amrick. I'm the community developer here at Studio SF. I just drive the bus full of the crazy musicians such as Brian. And Brian this week wrote our Backtrack Spotlight. If you're not familiar with the Backtrack Spotlight, where have you been? Once a week, we pick a song that's already in the 600 song plus library. I actually don't know what the current total is, but I'm sure somebody in the chat is about to say, "Well, actually, I've done the math." Because if you're good with math, your voice automatically goes up like two octaves. But we pick one of those and we sort of dig into it a little bit more from a musical theory perspective or a technique perspective or sometimes both, a couple of historical tidbits. And this week, it's What I Got by Sublime. Mm-hmm. And you connected the dots on something that I was amazed I had never noticed before, because I'm a pretty well-known huge Beatles fan, and you drew a link between What I Got and the structure of a famous Beatles song, a very famous Beatles song. You want to say which one that was?
It was Lady Madonna.
Yeah, so what's the connection between those two songs? Or it's not necessarily a direct connection, it's just that you found a musical similarity between them that you may not have, I mean, I certainly never realized it.
Yeah, the vocal melody at the beginning of What I Got bears a striking resemblance to the melody of the chorus of Lady Madonna. They are very similar.
Can I sing it over it when we...
You could, you absolutely could. It's in a different key, but...
Sure.
You definitely could.
So if you want to read, your write-up is much more than that. It deals with sort of how to make a song with two chords interesting and what drives that song and doing that kind of stuff. So if you'd like to learn a little bit more about the music theory behind What I Got by Sublime, go to our forums at rocksmith.com. If we're really lucky, maybe somebody will throw it into the chat as a direct link. I don't have my machine in front of me. Because, yes, everybody said, oh, Dan's not going to play bass this week. I am if it's this song, because... It's so easy, I actually have not practiced it. I played it when this pack came out earlier this year. It was earlier this year, wasn't it? Or was it last year?
I think it was last year.
Was it last
Little
year?
Do you know, this is all tapping and slapping as well.
No! Oh! I haven't played it since whenever the damn thing came out. But I remember going, wow, that's easy. So, like Jared, I didn't have as much time this week as I thought I would. And so I'm playing it basically cold, So it's now I get to the real note tracker experience where you guys intensely play something and then suddenly have to move on to other stuff, and then you come back and you're like, oh, where was I 3 months ago in my head?
Yeah, exactly.
So we'll do this. This is available now, obviously, on all platforms. Yeah, I'm gonna guess at this.
It's got a good groove. It's a simple song.
Oh, it is. Yes, very simple, fun. Really fun groove. Reason that, as you said, it keeps getting airplay to this day. Yeah. It's like it's simple, but it's very effective. It's very hummable, and it feels great in your ears. Sort of like a moist Q-tip. Paying attention. If you're paying attention, you'll notice I never left that one riff. And you have to be able to do a hammer-on with your pinky, but other than that, dead simple. Good enough for me to do, let's say, 85%, because I assume 93 is you doing stuff correctly.
Maybe.
Yeah, I'll take 85 for not having played it since whenever the hell it came out. I'm very happy with that. But yeah, I mean, rock solid. Again, if you're looking for a song that is not too difficult in structure and that your friends are going to want to sing along to or hear you play at a campfire or wherever you find yourself, on a boat dock perhaps, sipping a martini on the beach this summer, that's a really good
That's
a really good song for people to chill out to.
Mm-hmm. It's got some arpeggiated stuff at the beginning that's kind of challenging. You can really just sort of fake your way through it.
As proof by me playing the bass, that's Tiny Little Dan Hands, hashtag Tiny Little Dan Hands in there. People pointing out that I don't have the most manly of reaches, the most macho of stretch. Hey, we actually have a little bit of time that I didn't think we would have, so I'm thinking maybe I jump out of this seat, we bring Brian McCune in to sit here, and we do some Q&A. This is our traditional Q&A section, and we still have a giveaway coming up. For which you should not be afraid. We will have some more Ernie Ball gear to give away a little bit later in the show. But we always like to take at least a couple of minutes to try to address either like old business, new business, things that are going on. I have an update on the Realtone cable issue. There's a lot of people who are having trouble finding Realtone cables. This almost always happens after a Steam sale like we had last week where the games were, both Rocksmith games were 40% off. Isn't that Ewan?
You're
doing guitar on the next track?
I'm going to be doing, yeah.
Oh, okay. Are you both doing guitar on the next track?
No, he's doing...
Oh, you're, oh doing that's the, right.
You
oh,
sorry. Slap at the bass.
Slap at the bass.
I was playing guitar. This is me.
Oh, yeah. That
makes sense. See, that's why I'm here. Anyway, what I'm saying is if you need one of these Realtone cables, that thank you very much for the shtick to get back to a... in Europe, they're a little hard to come by right now. They're kind of out of stock. We just had... some more show up at Amazon in the U.S. Now, they will ship internationally. The Uplay shop is currently out of stock as well, but you can get them at Amazon. Obviously, third-party sellers sometimes gouge for these. Remember two things. One, they are universal, so if you have one lying around from a PS3 version and you want to use it on PC, or if you have a friend with a PS4 version and you want to try it on your Xbox One, it's okay. It's all the same cable. It doesn't matter. As long as you can find any Realtone cable, you're good to go. So you may find that maybe there's a used version out there, or maybe there's something that's marked down or on clearance at a local store because they're like, ah, it's an old game. Why would anybody want to play that? But you know better. And the other thing is that we will have some more later on in the summer, late summer. There is a very large batch being manufactured over the summer, and probably by the end of August, I think probably late August, we will see those show up in the retail channel if everything goes well. But that being the case, it might be a long summer if you're currently without a cable and looking for one. So wanted to let you know, yes, we're making more. No, they won't be out for a little while. But in the meantime, any Realtone cable is the right Realtone cable when it comes to Rocksmith. How are you doing, Brian?
I'm doing great.
How are you doing, Brian?
I'm doing excellent.
We don't have any more Brians. Ran out of Brians.
We'll make some more.
We always call you Pody and McCune. Does that bother you? Do you feel like you're suddenly in like grade school where there's point at which
it's better
boys
than
in grade
M,
school?
Which I would definitely
Brian M. Brian M. and Brian P.
Yeah.
There's a, my teachers actually asked me, they're like, at what point do you guys stop calling yourselves by your first name and then just only refer to yourselves by your last name? Did you have that when you were in school? When people were
hey, Pody.
Yeah, I had.
Like,
it
we
a
call
lot.
You Pody around here
that's
only
a
because.
Cool last name. That's
yeah,
a good
it's
one.
Totally fine.
It's different, you know?
Yeah.
Let's see.
Are we just going to jump into like an AMA? Or no
sure,
tracking?
Why not?
AMA.
Yeah, we
ask
can.
Ask me anything. If I'm allowed to answer it, I will.
All right, somebody says, I love you, Dan. Thank you.
Not a question.
Nope, but we're going to bring it up anyway. Because I need a little positive affirmation today. What is the most played song on Rocksmith, asks Bassman71. I believe this is publicly available data that you can go to rocksmith.com and find. If you go to the stats page.
I always think it's, Are You Mine? The Trooper is up there, but it's not number one. But yeah, Are You Mine is first.
I think it actually is Are You Mine.
Or Pour Some Sugar on Me. But yeah.
That's definitely in the top five. I believe we have the top 10 most played songs. Like physically the data that is representative of what people are playing the most in the song in the game. And I'm pretty sure that Are You Mine is number one. But that's on rocksmith.com. Poke around and look for player stats. I think it's part of the 60-day challenge. If you go below the 60-day challenge personal stats, you'll see some global stats too. Let's see. Oh, I'd love to see a backtrack spotlight on Alter Bridge's Blackbird, says Boost D. We do take requests for those kind of things, and thank you for mentioning it in the chat. We always try to take a moment afterwards. We cut and paste the chat and look it over and check those out. But it's even better if you actually go to the backtrack spotlight articles that are in the forums and go there and let us know what you think there, because it's a little easier for us. We might miss it even if we copy and paste the chat. But it's better if you're part of the conversation about the backtrack spotlights. But yes, thank you. We like to hear that kind of stuff. Let's see. If a song is played with a 7-string guitar, says KDob74, and they don't play the high E, can the song be used in the game?
It's got a low B.
It's got to be the low B.
Right. That's the thing. On most 7-string guitars anyway, maybe not all, but on most commercially available ones, the 7th string is a low B, which is we have some material that was originally played on 7 strings where we just tune way the hell down to achieve
that.
I don't
think we've done. Have we done any seven string? I don't think we've done anything that was originally done on a seven string.
Isn't the lowest we've gone C?
C is the lowest we've gone. C standard is the lowest we've gone. We've encountered baritone guitar on some recordings instead of bass, but that's
usually a C.
But that's an octave shift kind of thing.
I think baritone, isn't it down a fourth? I'm not sure. Anyway, the
lowest
we can go is C standard. So unfortunately, we'll never be able to get that low B. Not never, but like in a current iteration of Rocksmith, but.
Funk asks, how likely is it that we could expect another band to have a second pack like the Foo Fighters in the near future? I've already requested more Iron Maiden, more Megadeth. This is a good point. The only band I think that we've done a second pack for so far is the Foo Fighters.
Correct.
And it's called Foo Fighters 2. Unless you count Rage Against the Machine, which does have Rage Against the Machine 1 and 2, or everything as a 7-pack.
And Hendrix 1 through
and 4. Hendrix has packs 1 through 4, which are also available.
Don't rule it out. Keep requesting what you want to play, because we're looking at that, and I'm looking at that nearly daily. So,
yeah,
you know,
it's
not a black box. We've said that.
Right, the request
often,
app.
Yeah, and... Yeah, we're looking at it. So if you want it, we're doing our best to try to get the people what they want, but we're at the mercy of what licensing can get us and who wants to work with us.
Yeah.
But we want to give the people what they want.
But yeah, there was a fear because we didn't do a second pack for any bands for so long that it was sort of like one shot and you're done. And so a lot of people are like, oh, but my favorite song wasn't in there. And as we've shown, like, there are some artists that had a pack that now we're going back and we're able to fill some things in. Singles, Crazy Little Thing Called Love was in the
exactly.
The Queen by Queen was in the Rockabilly pack. So even if we don't get a full pack, if you've got a specific song in mind, which is the only way to use the request app, we need to know exactly what songs you want, because we don't, we've said this a couple times in the past, we don't just go to the bands or the band's representatives and say, could we have, like, some songs? You know, we have to deal for very specific. We would like the license for this particular track, the master recording from this year by this artist, published through this company, and all that stuff. So we have to be specific. All we ask is you tell us artist and song.
Yeah.
And please, when you're using that request app, do not write my favorite band and then song anything!
Exclamation. That
really doesn't help. We're like, look, we might be a fan of that artist too, but it's not the way that we need to represent your interests, because inevitably, I know that when people say anything and then we get like three songs that we can get, like for instance, there were some people expecting different Primus songs this week. We got you the ones that we could get. We have requested other Primus songs, but they didn't clear. So, you know, what are you going to do? We're not going to wait forever. We're going to put out the songs that we can get, and maybe we'll be able to, if the licensing works out for some of those other tracks later, maybe. But right now, we got to go with what we know. But yeah, don't put down anything. Be specific. You have a favorite song. That's what we want to hear, because that's what you would want to play. You don't want to hear, like, the lock groove, you know, of your favorite album where there's just nothing. I Love You, Dan? Yeah. Somebody made it into a question.
Thank you,
Pete.
Thank
Much
you,
appreciated.
Internet.
our chat room is nothing if not a bunch of smart asses, so you can count on that every time.
I enjoy
it. Did he basically confirm another Rocksmith is on the way? No. Did you get that?
I did not do that.
I don't think any of us did that. We are continuing to make DLC until they tell us to stop. Right now, they haven't told us to stop. They haven't even given us an end date. So we're good to go with continuing DLC. As for a future title, we don't know. We have great ideas. You've given us tons of great feedback and suggestions. We have had discussions about, gee, I'd like to be able to do this, or do you think maybe we could do that? But no, we don't have anything to announce. We didn't announce anything at E3. We're not planning on announcing anything tomorrow. We're just, you know, it's just we're going to keep supporting it with DLC, because this just doesn't seem like the kind of game where you need to have an annual installment. You know, it's not a Madden. It's not a Call of Duty. Guitar is a much longer, lifelong personal process. So why make you buy a brand new $80 game or $60 game if you don't have to, right? That's the way we look at it anyway. Okay, I'm seeing just a couple other things. People are saying, what about this artist? What about that artist?
Yeah.
People
Anything
have already
not artist specific.
People have already put in the link to the request app. Go right ahead. This game needs this. This game needs this. Would it be possible, last question for today, would it be possible to release new Guitarcade games as DLCs, says Hammer 249? This is something we get fairly often. Can you do some more lessons? Can you do some more Guitarcade? In theory, yes.
You could.
Because you've noticed, as many people have pointed out, what goes in the expansions part of the menu. If you go to the shop, it says songs, packs, and expansions. And that's there in case we ever, you know, like, because bass was added to the original game through that expansions portal.
We didn't know what there would be left to. So it was basically insurance.
It's been insurance. Better to be prepared and not need it. It's like bringing an umbrella.
And there is nothing currently planned for that expansion thing.
Theoretically, yes, guitar games could be added. Lessons could be added. Are we planning on doing that? No, I'm sorry, we're not. Pretty much what I like to say is Rocksmith is feature complete at this point. 2014 teaches what it teaches. Again, we've talked about, what else would we want to teach if we ever got the opportunity? But that's neither here nor there. And I lied. One more thing. Dan, what about your shirt? This is the Great Great House of Guitars in Rochester, New York, where my in-laws are from. Hi, in-laws, if you're watching. I got to tell you, if you ever get a chance to go to Rochester, first of all, have a garbage plate. It's a local delicacy. It's basically it's just a pile of food. It's like the hangover food that people go to get at diners in the middle of the night or at food trucks. It's the like, oh man, I need some carbs to soak up all the beer that I've been drinking. And the garbage plates are just insane, like fries and jalapenos and sausage and beef and sort of like you name it. It's just very weird. And the other thing is the absolutely greatest place that I've ever bought a guitar is the Great Great House of Guitars. The first floor is all guitars. The second floor is all basses. The third floor is all keyboards. It's physically an old like Victorian house. And what's even better is that it has slowly expanded to where they bought like the house next door and then created like a tunnel between them. So there's hallway and then there's a giant record store, an actual honest to God, full on vinyl, CD and T-shirt record store like they don't have anymore, filled to the rafters. And then famous people have come by and they all sign the wall between the two buildings. So I just spent half an hour one day just looking and like Weird Al Yankovic has signed the wall, you know, like just finding people that I recognized and liked. So yes, Great Great House of Guitars. If you have a local guitar store with a really cool T-shirt, that's something I want to know about because I do like to rep the indie music stores out there. So just drop me a line. Hey, you want to play a song?
I want to try.
Hey, you want to run the board? Brian Pody is going to go back to the Wheels of Steel. Thank you, Anthony Martinez, for running the
Greg
Wheels of
Barr.
Steel. And welcome, Greg Barr. Oh, you're going to do this one. You're going to do Tommy the Cat on the Epiphone viola. Now we had talked a little bit. Here you go.
Should we switch spots or do you care?
I don't care as long as the cables are correct.
I'll
scoot
over a scotch.
We had talked a little bit about what the right hardware is, like what kind of bass to play slap and pop. Obviously, Fender's jazz basses have always been very popular. Modulus's stuff and some of the Ernie Ball stuff, the Stingray, and I love the Sterling myself, and I've been goofing off a little bit with popping at home.
And the Epiphone viola bass.
And the Epiphone viola, which you wouldn't think. I got to say, that bass has turned out to be way more versatile than we ever expected it to be. We've played every single style of music. We played metal on that thing. We've played classic pop and funk. And today we're playing whatever the hell you call Primus. Experimental alt-rock is kind of our avant-garde insanity is what I've heard it referred to as well. But is there any particular style of guitar that makes it better or worse for doing the techniques of slapping and popping and stuff like that?
Not that I personally know of.
That's where you're wrong.
Oh, I do know.
You do, yes. Yeah. David Stevens had suggested something with one pickup at the bridge so that you don't have your hands bumping into a front pickup on a two, which of course you will have because the viola has two pickups. But that was his one suggestion. And sure enough, when I look at like the basses that Flea plays, for instance, a very prominent funk player, does a lot of slapping and popping. He generally plays with just a bridge pickup and, again, gets a really bright, gnarly tone out of there because he's playing lead bass at that point.
So
Tommy the Cat is one that you transcribed, yes, Greg?
I did.
How you feel about that, Greg?
I'm nervous. Well, I'm going to play it at 70%, I think we're at somewhere around there. So it's pretty much gonna level me up, hopefully not past where I'm comfortable with, but we'll see about that. I can't play this whole thing, I have no shame about that. It's really difficult. The slapping and popping is really fast. But the leveling is really solid on this. So I would say level it up like this, like you're gonna see here, and then once you can't play it anymore, then throw it in riff repeater. But the leveling will give you a really good sense of, you know.
Right. Earlier in the show, I sort of mentioned that it's sort of like giving you signposts on a path, you know, like, so you always have these landmarks, and that's what it builds on. It gives you sort of the root notes, and the most important notes are the things that stick out the most, and then it fills in around those notes.
Yeah. And if even if you play, like, at this level, I'm going to play it now, if you played this, you know, on through an amp for your friends, they would know what it was, you know.
Right.
They
would. They'll give you a... They'll give you a little credit.
Of course, I mean, it's not very tonal, so maybe they wouldn't. I don't know. It's
depends on how big a fan your friends are of Primus, I suppose. All right, well then, let's give Tommy the Cat a try. This is the first time we've played all more than three songs from one artist on a stream. Kind of cool. This is one of the four songs available in the Primus song pack, available now on all six of our platforms. Good luck, Greg. We're all counting on you.
Brian, the guitar part's... Oh,
no, Brian's fine. Do you see that?
I will not be fine. Today, I am a narcissist.
I'm sure you're going to be just fine.
Nope.
Oh, and the chat room is just full of cat icons now and emoji. Cocky Rooster, it doesn't mean anything. You're reading way too far into it, my friend. Did you notice how they're saying we're not working on one, so we have nothing to announce? It's the same thing to me. Just don't worry about it. Oh, if I'd known that, I would have just waited to talk over that. Say, baby. I'm sorry.
Do it now. Talk.
Remember, that's old meal ago.
I knew he'd nail it.
Real backfiller to reform out of this little twain to his mighty throat. Many a fatal rat met his demise while staring point blank on the cover's barrel. This sauce.
I chipped my front tooth to this song in 10th grade in a Primus mosh pit, says Chris 6119. That's dedication, man. Hope you got some dental work. Yeah, I was gonna say I don't think you have anything to be ashamed of, Greg.
It's about to get a lot worse.
Somebody asked, do I have my clue ready? No, I do not. I'm actually pretty far behind on that. Maybe there won't be a clue tomorrow. What do you think about that?
Right.
You gave me this conspiratorial look like, I wonder if they'll notice.
Say, Pepper, do you want to lay down by my side? Pepper, do you want to lay down with me? Say, Pepper! Say, Pepper! Say, Pepper!
Well right. survived. Well yeah. done, Greg. And pretty good, Brian.
It's pretty bad.
No, I thought you did fine. What's your numbers? 80, look at that. 84 and 96. Come on, man. You guys are doing great. Yeah. You know what? I love you, Brian.
Oh, thank you.
There's your affirmation for the day.
I practiced that a lot, and I started at like 38% speed. It's the slowest I've ever had to go. I just took that whole middle solo section, put it at 38%, and I was like, okay, what's happening? What's happening? Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. And I got it up to 88, and that's where I maxed out. And that's when I started to travel through time and all these things
right,
happened.
Right, good for you.
No, I went on a date with my mom.
Marty!
My mom. Okay. No.
Excellent.
No, I got it to 88%, and then I think I would need another month to get it up to
right,
where
kidding.
I could like actually like play it and have it make sense.
Did you have fun playing it at 84%?
I did.
Oh, okay,
I,
oh, yeah, then.
Yeah. Well, 84% that's... accuracy. Yeah.
Well, whatever, yeah. Like, that's all that matters, man.
Greg, do you want to talk some more about?
I do. Yeah, I want to show the bass part because I can play it. I just can't play it at top speed. But it's basically just a pattern that repeats the whole time. And sometimes he moves it up here at one point during the solo, but it's the same pattern. So it's basically just yeah, you want to get a right hand shot. Right. But he does this
Ooh,
strum,
right
so
hand.
It's he strums kind of like with his fingers. So I usually do downward with my
yeah,
index or middle.
Okay,
and then up with the thumb. So.
Just faster and faster.
And it's just way faster than that. But there's basically, so there's a lot of mutes. So you'll see in the note track, there's a ton of mutes.
Those little percussive clicks in between
right.
of like not actually playing a note, but
exactly.
tapping
and that,
the string.
The way you do that is just you just lift your hand slightly off Ooh. The fret instead of pushing down. You just, you know, you'd be pressing down here. You just, that's all it is.
Right, you touch the string.
You just touch
but
the
you
string.
You don't really fret it all the way.
Right, so you get all these kind of weird false harmonics and stuff, and that's really what he's all about. And there's another part in the middle. Do you want to go to that middle part?
Go up my nose?
Yes, What's I happening? Can. No problem.
Can you go to those small phrases over there? This is the other part that's really weird that we had to get very creative with because he just it's basically a bunch of like unpitched. Slaps and pops and then some two-handed tapping
mm-hmm.
yeah, all the way up and then just can you slow it down a bunch to maybe like 50% or something.
So what we're doing is we're Brian Pody's going into riff repeater off screen. You can't see him driving the bus at the moment, but you can do this. We talk about this all the time. Riff repeater lets you play the song your way, focus in on specific parts that you're having trouble with, change the complexity, change the difficulty, the speed. This is how we learn stuff when we have trouble learning stuff. And it's
right.
available to you as part of Rocksmith 2014. Not just a jukebox, it turns out.
And this is just a pattern, too. You can probably see it.
Oh.
Random notes that I didn't really learn.
Right.
So it is a pattern. If you go in there and slow it down, you will see what it is. But basically, that first little bit is slaps and pops with the right hand, and then just kind of slapping with your left hand from
mm-hmm.
nowhere. Just kind of he just hits it with his ring finger. So it's. So it's just a pattern between this.
It can be learned.
It can. And then the other part is just him going up the fretboard. And then tapping at the 11th fret.
And then pulling
then sliding,
it.
Sliding,
yeah.
So, you know, watch videos. That's helpful.
Yeah. In this case, again, like Les's technique is his own. It's kind of
yeah.
hard to note, let alone reproduce in performance, all the stuff that we're talking about here because... it's not like he's sitting down and going, you know what, I think I want to hit the 19th fret on
right.
this one. He's sort of in the moment, you know, and we say that so many times. There's a lot of solos passages of songs that are in Rocksmith where if you're obsessed with getting 100% mastery, like some of that stuff is just personal expression, and you're basically getting 100% mastery on somebody else's personal expression. Mm-hmm. Don't get too hung up on getting 100%. We know that, you know, like, it feels good to reach that goal. But if you're playing the song well and you're putting your own spin on it, that's all that matters.
Yeah, listen.
Again, like, when I played Jerry on guitar, I didn't know what the hell I was doing. I just hit random notes, and they sounded good, and the audience didn't know any different. And they were like, wow, that's amazing. I'm like, is it good? Because I totally had you fooled, you know? you know, that's okay. If it sounds good, it is good. I'm a big fan of that totally. School of music. The if it sounds good, it is good school of music.
I agree.
It's a banner over top. Mm-hmm. I don't know what their motto would be in Latin, but I'm sure the chat room will fill it in because they all know Latin. Hey, how about one more giveaway and then we get the hell out of here? Is that good?
Sounds great.
Did we do the giveaway? We haven't given away the last Ernie Ball thing, have we? Damn, I was kind of hoping you'd say, uh-huh, so that we could all take the prizes for ourselves. Instead, we'll give them to you. Here it is. We have our final Ernie Ball pack. And as you can see, this is something that anybody out there can use. If you play guitar, how about two sets of strings? One of those sets of strings that is shown in this photo is M Steels. It's not really M Steels. It's Cobalts, because they sent us some Cobalts. Now, if they send us more Cobalts, I guess I'm going to have to retake the photo. but two sets of guitar strings. The Cobalts are higher output. Than the standard regular Slinkies, but I've been using those lime green regular Slinkies for years, and I like them. You've got some Wonder Wipes to keep your guitar shiny and clean and your fretboard moisturized. You've got the... Oh, McCune. McCune, you've done it again.
I'm not doing anything.
No, of course not. And a brand new strap, a peg winder.
It's upsetting.
I'm sorry. A peg winder and a dozen medium picks with the guitar pack. I give heavy ones away when we do the bass pack, and of course, three of our very rare. That's the word. I'm like, how come I can't find the word rare? The rare Rocksmith picks as well. So one person's going to get these. Jason Paradise will tell you what you need to do to enter to win. I do know that you have to be following us here on Twitch for that. But also, I need your name, your address, and your phone number. We won't use any of that information for anything nefarious. It's just so that our mailroom has the information to send you what you need and also to give the delivery company your phone number so in case something goes wrong with your delivery. We don't want that. The guitar pack is worth, I always put down about $30-$35. That's not a small amount of gear to drop on somebody. So you don't want that going to the wrong house. You want that going to you. And to do that, we need your information. So I have no idea what you guys are doing to me during my outro, but thank you very much for tuning into the super technically challenging Primus stream this week. What we'll be doing next week is a surprise, and you'll get a hint about that surprise tomorrow if I get my butt in gear and my brain in gear, really, because that's where the puzzles come from. We'll do a little puzzle kind of hint thing that gives you some inkling of what's coming next week. We will do that tomorrow in our forums at rocksmith.com. Look in the DLC section. So if you aren't already doing that, you might want to start doing that. And you might want to look at some of the older puzzles to see just how weird they get. But hopefully it'll be fun and a little tease. And I will say this much. I think you will be surprised next week. But other than that, thanks for watching us. You can follow us on social medias. And we'll be giving away some more codes tomorrow on social medias. If you follow Ubisoft Studio SF on Twitter, we'll give away some... Yeah, I almost made it all the way through, damn it. We'll be giving away some more of these Steam codes for Primus on Twitter. We'll also drop some in our official forums and over in Reddit as well. We love you guys hanging out in Reddit talking about the game. So we'll give away some more codes tomorrow. Follow us on @RocksmithGame as well, just for more general information. And we have Facebook outposts for /Rocksmith as well as /UbisoftStudioSF. I'm not going to let them win. I'm going to say let's cut to the trailer, see one more look at the Primus material. We'll see you next week. Thanks very much, everybody. Goodbye.
Girls are nice for driving. The girls have got the
with me.
For teen.